Ah, okay. And now we have even more famous typos. So we have a cellular infrastructure. Not sure if that's related to calluses, but okay. So we have a roadmap, and we have a bit of a discussion or a presentation of the roadmap at this point of the day, before we head into lunch. Once again, lunch is postponed by half an hour, as indicated earlier. So, yeah, roadmap. So, well, actually, let me increase the font size. So, luckily, I don't need a mouse for that. Let me basically start with a bit of a disclaimer. So, I mean, this all started with people like Dieter or Holger or Daniel or I, who basically invested spare time, and we did this because it's fun. And it's still fun today. It's a lot of fun. But at some point, of course, everyone needs to earn money. And in the early days, we had a regular day job, and which was unrelated to that. I did Netfilter stuff or whatever, or some other work. We did Osmocom for fun. And then we got first traction by, luckily, some operators, including OnWaves, which we will hear later about today. Very happy for their support, even very early on, in basically funding some of the development that we guys will be doing. And in this context, this has continued, and now we have, for example, Sysmocom, but we also have lots of freelancers. We have other companies in and around Osmocom, like Fairwaves and so on, who are able to do development. But in the end, the development that we see today is driven by, well, either what people are contributing patches for, so no matter what kind of roadmap I put here on the slide, who is going to do it if somebody has to do it in the end, or of course what companies or the consultants or whatever that can get contracts for, so if they do a freelance work or something like that. So yeah, basically, unless somebody commits to putting resources in whatever form, there's not going to be much behind any kind of roadmap. So, but in general, sort of what's more visible on the horizon is, I think, the following five items. So splitting up the network in the box, Niels has already given quite some preview on that in his talk about the 3G work, where right now we basically have a NITB that's split in two parts, and only one of the two parts still works, which is the MSC part. In the context of 3G, we are now implementing the complete A interface between MSC and BSC, and then basically all networks will look like that. I'll have a couple of slides about that. Code quality issues in general, which sort of relates a bit to testing. We have the integration between 2G and 3G, because right now they exist in parallel universes and there's no inter-RAD handover or something like that. And also improvement of addition of external interfaces, which sort of all relates to what we've been hearing today. There's no grand, master plan about a roadmap what we will do in 2 years from now, because as I said, it doesn't really matter what we put on here on these slides. So the network in the box has been at the heart. It has lots of issues. We already discussed that, at least if you go in a deployment beyond your desk. And now, rest in peace, network in the box. Long live Osmo MSC. So Osmo MSC is the network in the box minus the BSC and minus the HLR. I stay with this slide. Too fast. So we have this HLR with the GSUB interface. We will have the A over IP interface, where right now the work, so far most of the work has been in the lower layers, but we now have a brand new SCCP and M3UA stack, which is in libosmo sigtran. So all the lower layers underneath the A interface protocols. We have the IUCS and IUPS interfaces in the home node B gateway, which, what Niels didn't mention, are in the current code are over SUA, the SCCP user adaptation, which is not 3GPP compliant to have this kind of stacking. So that is now also in branches, not in master, is moved over to this new M3UA SCCP stack. And we want to basically merge all those branches and move to a single code base for 2G and 3G to have all these features integrated. And this also means that the NITB is gone, and for a 2G setup, you will have Osmo BSC and Osmo MSC and Osmo HLR running. So the network in the box can still be there, but the box is then, let's say, well, no pun intended, a virtual box or a physical box. And you still have multiple processes inside. And now one of the challenges is how do we transition to introducing all these interfaces without making the configuration much more complicated and introduce many more ways to configure it wrong in a non-functional state? And this is some of the time that I've spent on thinking about how can we be compliant with the 3GPP interfaces, but at the same time sort of abuse or interpret or extend them in a way to avoid having all this configuration inconsistency that can and having to understand many more protocols and so on. So one of the parts that we will also have in this setup, and which in fact we already have, but not in master, is also the Osmocom STP, which then acts as a signal transfer point for all these SCCP connections with M3UA. It's used only with the A and IU interface at the moment. So don't I thought I had a slide about this, but okay, sorry for that. That's going to be in there. And basically, this is going to play a key role in assigning the addresses and avoiding having all kinds of configuration only on those new interfaces. This is basically about the split. The other thing that we get by merging all this new world, for which we don't have a name yet, basically is we introduced, as Niels already said, also Max referenced it, the Osmocom FSM infrastructure, which is a way how we can abstractly describe finite state machines in C. So quite powerful construct to have very good, well-defined state machines with timeouts in all places, with introspection and so on. And the old NITB doesn't have any of that because it's much too old for this infrastructure, but the new Osmo MSC and the VLR code in there has it. And some other parts of the code also have it. So we'll get this. The other thing where we'll see progress, I think, is on the Osmocom primitives, which is how we encapsulate primitives between protocol layers. This has been around for quite some time, I think ever since Osmocom BB, actually, but in a very, minimal use. And I would like to get the Osmocom primitives also in a state where they can sort of self-describe themselves or as a general way. So you could basically print primitives at any layer boundary or something like that. So you can really see there is a primitive now going from left to right, and this is all the parameters of the primitive without anyone having to write code that writes printf statements or something like that. Because one of the advantages of Osmo FSM is also all of the logging, like which event happened, which state transition has happened, for which particular instance of which FSM, all that is handled by the core infrastructure, and you don't have to put printfs or whatever or log statements into the code anymore. So we have lots of code that doesn't have any explicit log statements anymore because all of this is handled implicitly. And that's with the primitives, I also would like to see that. I had the slides. So the Osmo FSM we have introduced in several places in the OM2000 code for Ericsson. That's the OML protocol of Ericsson. Connection-oriented SCCP, M3UA, SUA, the application server process, state machines, all the VLR FSMs, and also the AMR DTX state machines that Max recently introduced in Osmo BTS use this. We have some candidates that we would like to convert. This is LabD, LabDM code, which still giving trouble even after all those years being used because of some untested code paths or some, you know, not so explicitly coded parts would definitely benefit from that. The Avis OML managed objects, which is what is used to bring up the BTS, also definitely needs some more formalization. It's basically a big grown hack ever since the first BS11 support. Would be nice to also convert call control to Osmo FSM, because then you could also have introspection about in which state the call is currently in from some external visualization tool or whatever you might want to have. And it might even be an idea to model those state machines on the camel call state machines. I'm not sure if anyone is familiar with that, but camel is the customized applications for mobile enhanced logic, which is basically how a lot of prepaid control and so on is done in cellular networks. I'm not saying we want to support Camel, but I'm saying, well, if we introduce more formal state machines, we could make sure that our state machines at least look like something that could be used for Camel at some point in the future. Yeah, of course. Well, but then these kind of infrastructure internal exchanges, if I'm saying, yeah, who wants to invest in that? Any volunteers? That's the big problem. If there is commercial support or commercial interest, like, oh, I need this interface or this new driver or I need this feature, but you know, real infrastructural improvements is always difficult, of course. Which also applies to testing. I mean, the unit testing code of coverage of the code, well, it exists and we have unit tests everywhere. And as Holger mentioned, it is a progress. But still the coverage, I didn't measure it, but just from knowing the code, the coverage is not all that great. So that needs more attention. New code coverage is generally much more better. So code that was introduced the last 2 years or so has much better unit test coverage than the old code that has been around for forever. This control interface introspection into the finite state machines that Max mentioned can also help us to write even better testing. Because now you can send a message to some implementation. This message creates a state machine or transitions a state or something like that, and then you can check if that state change actually has happened in the code as it was expected. On the other front, like going from the unit tests to systematic end-to-end tests, we have something called the Osmo GSM tester, which is a Python framework for doing actual full system tests. So basically you use a bank of GSM modems and you use a coaxial RF network and you use one-to-many BTSs. And then there is lots of Python code that can basically start all the network elements, execute individual test cases like make a call from A to B, send an SMS to from A to B, register, unregister, something like that. And this basically doing a full test from a phone basically to the core network or from a phone to a phone even in an automatic fashion. And that's has made great progress. We're already doing basically a second version of the code architecture right now. Or it's rather finished what Niels has been doing. We also have created quite comprehensive hardware setup to enable us to do this, and then we can also test across the different BTS platforms, because initially it was easy, we had the BS11 and that was fine, and we had the BS11 and NanoBTS, okay, two BTSs to test something on, you know, but then Nokia and Ericsson and Osmo BTS with UMTRX, with USRP, you have the Sysmo BTS, you have Octasig, you have, you know, all kinds of different models, and it explodes. Even a simple call test between A to B, you need to be able to systematically execute that on all the different platforms and get proper results. And that's going to be really soon now to have this system up and running. We will not do this for every commit, of course. I mean, probably takes hours, but maybe once per day, have like they could take a nightly snapshot and do the full test run for all these test cases. Sorry, I always speak ahead of the slide. So we were occupied by a lot of problems with the modems we initially choose. We now have hardware that supports mini PCIe modems, so we can basically use any modem. I can choose the modem based on how well it works, not based on what is available in the market. We don't have 3G support in the test cases yet, so that also needs, or 3G even starting the Osmo MSC and starting the home node B gateway and so on, so that's not part of it. We don't have voice testing as such. We can do signaling testing, but voice testing means you also need to look at the audio. Does the audio actually get through? And then getting through is not sufficient because, you know, are there dropouts? Are there maybe RTP packets being dropped? So this yet another domain that needs to be added to the Osmo GSM tester at a later point to be able to have actual tests of the voice stream, because just the signaling is fine, okay, but how do you know that your RTP traffic is getting from A to B? That's a completely different question and must be tested separately. Okay, external interfaces. Well, we already heard about control and VTY. Yeah, it's definitely on the roadmap to put more effort into the completeness of the control interface. But really, I think the easiest way is if people just tell us what they need in the control interface, then we can add it. Because typically adding, exposing something over the control interface is super easy if it's just a single variable or something like that. This is really like 2-3 lines of code, literally, to expose a certain setting or to make it configurable over the control interface. But for us, it's really hard to predict all the different things that people might want to configure through the interface. And the VTY interface get automatically added during development because, well, what do you do if you write code? You want to check whether it's working, and you use the output of the VTY to see what's happening as a developer. But the control interface, you don't automatically add yourself because you're a human being and not a program. So as a human being, you use the VTY interface, and so the control gets left behind. Yeah, and then we have, as Max already said, the grand unified config theory, which, I'm not very optimistic that much will happen there. I mean, I definitely have lots of ideas about the architecture, how something like that should look like. But yeah, as I said, interestingly, there's nothing to be found in the free software world that does anything that, with the kind of requirements, or even near the requirements that we have. Most of the config management libraries or whatever you can find in free software are about reading a config file when you start up and then never changing any of that. And that's not what we do. So we need this interactiveness. We need to be able to write the config back from the running configuration and so on. That's to anyone who is not like in this specific world of network infrastructure, I don't think anyone has seen that. And it's pretty alien to a lot of software out there. Okay, the integration, yeah, I said already also, we need the cross-advertisement of neighbor cells. There's some improvement already. So we can now advertise, I think, 3G and 4G neighbor cells on GSM. Max has been doing quite some work on that. Also, we can advertise the 2G neighbors from the femtocell, from the 3G femtocell, because that's actually a feature of the femtocell itself, not a feature of our code. So those two things already exist to some degree. But of course, there's no mobility between the two worlds, and particularly no handover. That's where it gets even more interesting. Or even things like, which I always wanted to do, combine packet switched and circuit switched attach. SMS over packet switched services, also something that I would have wanted, you know, 5 years ago or so. But yeah, you know, there's only so much we can do. In terms of operation and maintenance, also we need to improve. There has been some work already. We generate more, or we have the capability of generating OML alarms now in the code, which we didn't have for a long time in Osmo BTS. Those alarms get reported back to the BSC, and the BSC can then issue a control interface traps. So basically, if you have, let's say, 100 BTSs, all the alarms of the BTSs can get reported today already in one location rather than at 100 sites. But we don't generate that many alarms yet. So basically, what we need to go through the code and see what kind of abnormal situation should actually raise an OML alarm, what kind of events are the events that we want to notice in the first place. Also, in terms of statistics and counters, a lot of work has happened last year in exporting all the counters and exporting more counters, particularly regarding key performance indicators on the control interface. There it is useful, there it is nice that any counters we add automatically get added to the control interface, right? Because part of the infrastructure. So as soon as we add a counter somewhere, the counter is also accessible through the control interface without adding a single additional line of code. So that's rather easy also to add counters. But then with a lot of these key performance indicators, I mean, you can read through all the papers and what kind of values are defined as key performance indicator of any part of the GSM network. The detail is then always quite interesting, right? I mean, do you count the traffic before or after compression? Is the header included or not? You know, there's all kinds of details that are not so clear. So we have added quite a lot of counters, but I don't think we have received much feedback on how useful they are or if people are happy with them. So if you are into looking at the performance of your network, definitely we would love to hear more. What we don't have at all in Osmocom is the like any kind of tool to aggregate or interpret or do analysis of that, right? So we are focused on generating data at the moment and then hope that somebody consumes them in some way, either by just feeding all of that into Grafana or whatever, just whatever kind of tools people want to use these days to work on such data sets. But yeah, that's not really out of, I would say it's a bit out of scope for us, but it would be nice to at least have some reference implementation, some simplistic tool for people to look at. So this is more wishlist than roadmap now. The other parts are more like to some, with a higher probability and to already in progress to some. Definitely we want to move the SMSC out of Osmo MSC and thereby get rid of the last database part and the basically we want to be able to compile without any SQLite dependency. How exactly it's going to be happening is open still, but it's definitely something we want to do. The GSAP to map gateway, Holger has written something in Smalltalk to do that, but it's only for the GPRS side of things so far. So definitely it would be on the wish list for me to have some way that we have GSAP to map for both circuit switched and packet switched. Billing interfaces comes up every so often by various users, but then in most cases they don't really know what kind of information they want. And then we have the situation like, we need a billing interface. And we say, yeah, okay, what do you want? And they say, well, we need a billing interface. but what's your billing system? Well, we don't have a billing system, but we need a billing interface. So it iterates. Okay, so we need to do something, but apparently the typical users who request that from us are not capable of really explaining to us what exactly they need. So probably we need to do something in the hope it will be useful without knowing really what users will use. So it's a bit chicken and egg situation, I think. Yeah, and then, well, my big wish list item would be to also work on LTE stacks from the MME upwards. I don't think there's much point in trying to go from the MME downwards to go into basically doing an E-Node B or something like that, doing the RRC protocol and all the scheduling, all the low-level stuff. I think there's, unlike in UMTS, there is plenty of available LTE hardware out there from all kinds of vendors, small and big and in all forms and shapes. So I think our strength is really the protocol parts, and it would be quite interesting to do something. And yes, I'm aware there is OpenLTE, I'm aware there is OpenAI interface, though OpenAI interface is to a large extent not open source, even though they claim it. It's not an OSI compatible license. I think there is something we can do there, and I would want to do something in that area. But yeah, it's again a question of priorities and where can we cross subsidize or get project work in that area. There is some hope, but I'm not extremely happy. And the technical issues here as well. We don't really have good ASN1 tools for C in the free and open source software world. And I actually think that's the biggest issue at all in free software telecoms, that there is no good tools, not only for C, but also for other languages. It's rather limited unless you go for Erlang and maybe now Smalltalk. I'm not sure what's the state. I cannot judge myself, but I have heard good things about there. But outside, it's really problematic if you want to go for information object classes and unaligned packed and aligned packed encoding rules and so on. So basically, which means we either have to ditch C for doing work on those protocols or invest a lot of time in tooling. I would be very happy to even buy a developer license of a proprietary proprietary ASN1 compiler. But the problem is they always come with runtimes that are incompatible with free software. So you cannot really use them either. So that's a big problem. Otherwise, we could just have the compiler, and basically every time somebody does a commit on the ASN1 source, the server regenerates the C source code out of it on the server, and it would be fine. I don't think it's a problem for open source development if that compiler would be non-free. But as I said, the compiler needs a runtime, and that runtime is incompatible, and so we cannot use that. So that's sort of the stalling issue there. Okay. Once again, end of file, and we have 5 minutes for questions ahead of lunch. So, questions. Okay, well, I'm not sure where the second microphone went, but I can just give you, behind you. Suddenly, magically, a microphone appears.
This way, all right. Just a quick question about the database, getting the SQLite out of... getting the SMSC out of the Osmo BSC, so that only component that would be accessing the database then is the HLR.
And the SMSC, the external one.
And the SMSC, okay, but that would be handling whatever way it's doing it. So is there a plan, or would it be an idea to have abstract this database layer so that it's not limited to only SQLite and could be using other databases?
Well, if you look at the code, it's actually what we tried very early on. Right, we use DBI, which has support for different database drivers. It's just that by using DBI, we have basically introduced so many problems and performance penalties and bugs that never get fixed that it was not a very nice experience, to say. So, and I'm not aware of any other real C language database abstraction libraries that you would want to use at that point, which would improve it. And then in the end, I mean, I've done a lot of database work in the past, like long time ago, and you know, every database has different parameters anyway, and it needs to be, has different data type issues, and so that's, I'm not quite sure really how useful a generic layer is at that point, or whether, I mean, whether it doesn't make more sense to have like a dedicated database driver for each particular database that you want to support in the code itself. Something I did in other projects, which I found more comforting than using one of those general frameworks. So for example, with DBI, all the binary data gets wrapped in, like they transcode from 8-bit to some whatever, I say UUN code format. I mean, it's not really UUN code, but some base64 or whatever. And they don't use the binary native data types of the databases. And so if you use an external tool, then and you read out a binary, it's not really the binary, but it's some mingled data that the DBI layer has translated. And so, yeah, adds lots of issues. I mean, also what, let me maybe say this about Osmo HLR. Osmo HLR I see more as a, like, it's a really minimal reference implementation of an HLR. So this is not what I think you should use for a real large network. This is really just, we implemented something, the minimum necessary to talk the GSUB protocol and to perform the tasks that are required. So I just recently heard there is now a Python implementation of an HLR. We'll hear probably a bit about that later in the community cellular manager talk later this evening, where they have implemented the GSUB protocol in Python and they have a different HLR in there, for example. And I'm completely open to, I mean, whatever people want to do there, it doesn't have to be the particular Osmo HLR code that we have right now. Okay. Good. Then finally, we can go for lunch. My apologies. Please remain seated.
Okay.
Fasten the seatbelts.
I can suggest a very simple way to solve the SMSC issue you mentioned before. You can use the transaction mode of SMPP. It's a very simple way to avoid any storing in the NITB.
That's correct, yes. This, we implemented the transaction mode exactly for that use case in Osmo NITB that there's no storage involved, but then still it means we would have to supply a reference SMSC that is external, that uses this interface. And actually there's some more details, like how do you handle, let's say, the queuing of messages and the delivery once the subscriber comes back. And also, if you think more now with our HLR and more in an SS7-like world, the HLR needs to have something like message waiting flags. And, you know, so yes, but in general, I agree that is likely one way to do it, maybe even the way that we will do it. Yeah.